1039 Pratt FM, this is your morning with Richard and Chris, and joining me in the studio, I am so excited, it is Tegan and Sara. Guys, how are you doing?
Good, thank you for having us.
Oh my gosh, thank you so much for coming in. I'm so excited, I've been a fan of yours for so many years, and my dreams have finally come true. I get to meet you guys.
We're on your bucket list?
Yes, absolutely, so I can cross you guys off, well, even though that sounds a little bit ominous. But
sounds mean, yeah. Just say now, meet them again at that.
Okay, meet them again, yeah. Maybe backstage.
Oh
no,
yeah.
No
yeah.
Pressure.
Up the ante. I like it.
Just a little bit of a hint for next time.
Yep.
So your new album, Heartthrob, it comes out at the end of this month in January, and it's a little bit different than your other work, right?
It is. I mean, we've been making music now. I mean, we truly actually started making demos and recording as a band when we were 15. So we've been making music for over half our life. And just like music has changed and what's popular has changed, you know, we've grown and evolved and explored a lot of different things, you know, from punk music and indie music and more folk-based stuff. And our last couple records were maybe a little more indie rock. But definitely with each record, I think one thing that's remained consistent is that we try to change it up. And Heartthrob is no different than that. Like, it's definitely a change. But I think it fits within sort of what we've been doing, you know, a lot. We've been collaborating a lot, obviously, in the last 5 years with Tiesto and Morgan Page and David Guetta, and I think that we were just embracing our love of pop music currently and also our pop music love from the 80s, and so Heartthrob's sort of a product of all of that. So, but I think at its core, it's still, you know, a Tegan and Sara record. So,
and do you think that your fans were a little bit shocked when these collaborations started coming out?
I remember being particularly nervous about Feel It In My Bones, the collaboration that we did with Tiesto. It was sort of right before we released Sainthood, and I remember it was going to premiere on Stereo Gum. It was like this website, and I nervously kept refreshing, waiting for the song to get put up and then see what people's comments were. And I think we had one of the most like commented posts like ever on that day, because there were people who loved it, there were people that hated it, there were people fighting about it. And I think ultimately what I took away from the experience like months down the road was that it really truly opened up our band and our voice to a totally different genre of music. There was a ton of support from people in the dance community. We would have like dudes come up to us on the street and be like, "I work out, dude, you know, Feel It In My Bones," and like that had never happened to us before. And I thought like to myself, even if there was criticisms from certain people or there was discomfort from our own fan base, it was important to push ourselves. And I don't think that we could make everyone happy all the time. And it was a good lesson for us where the positive outweighed the negative. And I also think that it allowed something to click off in our brains where we didn't necessarily have to feel beholden to guitars or a sound or a genre or anything. I think Tegan and I have become, we've sort of transcended that. We get to just be ourselves, and we use our voices, and we sing on what we want, and we participate the way that we want and collaborate with the artists that we want. And I think that there's an acceptance now from our core fan base and thankfully from other fan bases, whoever we end up, you know, working with. So it's been a kind of a gift in a weird way, like that we've got to have that experience, because now I think it's made us probably much more ambitious and comfortable with our sound.
And Heartthrob is your 7th studio album, if fans can believe that. I can't believe it's been
crazy.
That long. When you started, do you ever think that you would make this shift in your style?
Well, like I said already, I mean, I just think that it's been a natural evolution. I you know, it's not like, you know, we have the obvious.
God, I'm not even sure we thought we would have a career.
Yeah.
Seven albums.
Exactly.
You know?
Like, I mean, you know, if you go back to the time when we made Under Feet Like Ours, it was just such a different. I mean, what was popular was so different. Dave Matthews Band was the most popular band, you know? So it's like, the way that we were making music and also the type of music we were making was very much influenced by what was going on in music. So, you know, for us, because we're actually fully submerged in our world, I mean, it doesn't feel like we've changed overnight. It's like, you know, we've made 7 records. So it's like kind of natural. Like it truly is as cheesy and cliche as it sounds to say. We just had a natural evolution over the last 15 years, and this is where we've arrived. And as Sara was just saying about the collaborative work we've done, the audience embraced it, the positives outweighed the negative, and it's really challenged us as writers and performers. And I think that we'll continue to do that moving on. Who knows what the next Tegan and Sara record will sound like.
Oh, boy, it's Tegan record.
The new Tegan record, yeah. The so new Tegan and Sara record. It might sound like Phil Collins. I don't know. Like, it's, you know, you just never know. And I think, you know, we talk a lot about having a career and having longevity, and I think in order to do that, you have to be consistently good, but I think you also need to constantly evolve and excite your audience, and I think this record is definitely a challenge, but it's good. So.
And when you mentioned the Tegan record, that little silver there, it actually reminded me of a question I've always wondered. The first like release that you guys had was actually under Sara and Tegan.
It's true. Yep.
Why did how did that come about, switching it up?
We hadn't selected a band name yet, and the way that our parents would always refer to us, or even our friends, was Sara and Tegan. I don't know why. That was just the way when
it's
we were growing
say.
Up, people would just say Sara and Tegan. And so when we were signing up actually for this competition in high school, it was like a band, you know, you send in your demo and you maybe get selected and then you compete in a battle of the bands type thing. We had to have a band name and we didn't have one yet. So we just wrote down Sara and Tegan. And once we sort of started off on our actual career, and we started playing festivals and that sort of thing, we realized that having the band name start with Sara was a little bit less, it didn't stick with people as much. There was a lot of like Sara McLaughlin and Sara Sleen and Sara, you know, there was other ones. Brightman, I think, actually was another one. Sara Harmer and Sara Sleen. Like there were so many Sarahs. And I just remember thinking that that it would probably stand out more if we had Tegan be the name. So it's been interesting.
No
though.
Hard feelings.
No, there's no hard feelings. I think it was completely a business move. But then the weird thing is that we've both said, you know, in retrospect, I think I probably wish we did have a band name. Like maybe it wasn't our names, but it's made us very like human and very relatable. I think because we really always are just artists, like under our own names. But there have been times where I definitely thought it would be nice to disappear behind something a little bit more broad that didn't bring all the attention onto who we, you know, are as individuals.
Right. I've read a little bit about your the process on which you guys write records, and I found it very interesting because you live on the opposite sides of the country, right?
And, that's right, yeah.
And it's in America and in Canada.
Yeah.
And so when you're writing an album, do you write separately then bring it together?
Yeah, pretty much since we started, that's what we've been doing. Sara moved to Montreal 10 years ago, so we've always been really comfortable just sort of writing and then coming together, whether it's sending each other music or actually like, you know, coming together in the studio to collaborate. But the bulk of our writing has been completely independent of one another. Definitely with Heartthrob, there was a lot more co-writing. Sara wrote pretty much all the bridges on the record. So, you know, I really wanted to change up our process this time around, but, you know, we didn't want to force it. We've tried to force it in the past. And because of all this collaborative writing, you know, experience we have now for other artists, it was like, well, maybe we can get away with doing it in our own band. And I think it's been really exciting because it's a fresh voice in the middle of the song. It's like a song like Closer, or a song like Drove Me Wild off the record. It's like the bridge comes in or the chorus comes in and there's just like this whole different perspective all of a sudden. And it truly feels like a collaborative record. So after so many years, that's really exciting too, is that we've done something really new and fresh. And that's like, oh, okay, well, maybe we can do this even more. Maybe we could actually like sit down and write a song together. What would that be like?
So since you do the most of the writing on your own, or previous to this record did you find that when you actually did come together, there was a lot of songs that fell to the wayside because they didn't fit in? Or are you guys just on the same twin wavelength?
We do a lot of writing. So generally what happens is that we just sort of start to accumulate, you know, dozens of songs. And it's less about a Tegan song and a Sara song. At the end of the day, you sort of are looking through, you know, this pile of songs and stuff starts to lump together. You know, oh, these songs really fit. You know, aesthetically, these ones don't fit. Or, you know, with this record, a lot of the stuff that was sort of grabbing everybody's attention all at the same time, it was more obvious, first listen type songs, stuff that was a bit more poppy, maybe more program stuff. Like Tegan and I were both building a lot of tracks, and you know, every once in a while we'd throw in like a guitar and drum song, and like those songs just didn't seem to fit as much. So it's competitive, but it's a lot of times it's just competitive with ourselves, like, you know, independently of like, I don't necessarily feel like I'm competing with Tegan all the time to write a good song. I'm just competing to write a good song. I want the record to be as strong as possible. And we very rarely fight for songs that shouldn't be on the record, as far as I'm concerned. There's very little debate. You can't disagree when you give somebody, you know, 20 demos to listen to. If people come up with the same songs over and over and over again, you'd be a real jerk to be like, no, but guys, this one that's just not really making the cut is one of my favorites. Let's put it on the record.
And we finally get to see the end result here. Heartthrob comes out on January 29th, mm-hmm. and I'm so excited. Got to be one of my most anticipated albums of 2013.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank
and
you.
You're very welcome. And so you guys have been touring a little bit recently as a supporting act for The Killers.
Yep.
Unfortunately, they dropped out in Toronto, but you guys still played an amazing gig at the Phoenix on your own. And are you going to be doing your own headlining tour?
Yeah, our plan in the next few weeks, once the record is out, is to start announcing some major touring. I mean, we're busy through to 2014, so there's a lot coming, and we're definitely coming to Toronto. So can't give it away anything more than that, but absolutely, people will be tired of us. Let's put it that way.
And make sure you stay tuned to your Twitter account at Tegan and Sara, where you'll be able to find all that information. And very quickly, I actually have a question from one of your Twitter followers that wanted to ask this, and I thought it was a very interesting question as well. They wanted to know if being happy and in love has helped or hindered your writing process.
Well, I say this all the time because when we finished touring the con, one of our diehard fans came up to me and actually said, like, you know, now that you guys are so happy, you know, you're just not going to be able to make a good record because, like, you were so depressed when you made the con. But the truth of the matter is that when we're happy, we're actually a little more motivated, I think. And, you know, I think that we are able to reflect on the past and we're able to go back and reprocess some of these terrible things that have happened or traumatizing or emotional or romantic things in a whole different light. And I think that I think going back and reflecting on our past has always been something that we're interested in doing in music. And so the combination of being motivated and, you know, at this point in our career, I think that we're making our best music. So I don't think it hinders it at all, you know.
Maybe actually when you're in a positive place, you know, reimagining or reflecting on things from the past, it becomes a little clearer.
Yeah.
You know, it's a little bit less clouded by, you know, being in the moment. I mean, I actually didn't write the con when I was in a bad place. I very quickly became depressed and was in a bad place when the record was done. But I actually think Sainthood, I was in a terrible place. And I think those songs feel a bit cloudy and dark to me now in retrospect. I love them, but they're a little bit harder to listen to. Whereas, you know, with this record, I think these songs are actually more more intense. At least my contributions to the record are a bit more emotionally intense. But I think it's just because I had this clarity, you know, like the clouds had parted and I was able to see everything a little differently. But it also made me able to tap into that sort of visceral description or energy in a more productive way. So take that, people who hate people who are happy.
Heartthrob drops on January 29th. Guys, thank you so much for coming in today. Again, for up-to-the-minute information, at Tegan and Sara on Twitter. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thank you.